Post-Romanticism, post-Impressionism is a French continuation, maybe late Debussy, maybe early Stravinsky, maybe early Vaughan Williams, maybe, but post-Impressionism, post-Romanticism would be more like Mahler, Richard Strauss. But at any rate, with Puccini, we're definitely dealing with a 20th century composer by the end of his life. He lives until 1924, and two through lines. Your last piece is an opera, and then you die. Your last piece is incomplete. Somebody else finishes it for you, and there's controversy for all time thereafter. The premiere of Turandot, or Turandot, with Arturo Toscanini, the conductor, laid down his baton, turned to the audience, and possibly said something along the lines of, here is where the master laid down his pen. This is also an example of chinoiserie, the first in our repertory, that enthusiasm, particularly of the French, for things Chinese and East Asian in general. And we will hear, perhaps, troped Chinese folk songs, could be even a little Japanese tinted in terms of the half steps in the pentatonic scales. But whatever, dark, dangerous, recitative, dissonant, we are in the 20th century. We have survived World War I. We're in the roaring 20s, but things are roaring in our heads. Jewish composer par excellence, post-romantic composer. Wonderful, strange, grows up poor, hears a lot of folk music, street music, military band sounds, sounds of nature, and in his first symphony, and he's a musical specialist again, he writes symphonies and orchestral art song cycles, and he's a conductor. He really makes his money doing conducting of opera, of all things. Never writes an opera, but the music is on the side. Are we actually going to make enough money to survive on the music? Better conduct. Very famous conductor. 9 symphonies. There'll be more to tell about that. But the opening of the first symphony, which by the way is either the most famous or second most important first symphony ever written. It's right up there with Beethoven's. I had the privilege of seeing the score of this piece at the Beinecke, if that's the right pronunciation, rare art, rare rare book museum at Yale University in a glass case in the foyer. Marvelous. At any rate, it opens with this sound of nature. Flageolet, flag, it says in the score, which is basically artificial harmonics on all the strings in seven octaves, all pretty much like real high. And then this little descending fourths, ascending second theme or motive that could be Pachelbel until it's not. It's do, so, le, oh, it's in minor, me, fa, but then instead of down to so, and do, it's ro, come on, drop, 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 and instead, whoops, goes up to re. And meanwhile, military fanfares, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da, eventually those fourths, which sometimes seem to allude to the cuckoo of Camille Saint-Saëns and real birds. Eventually you get a folk song as, that's all an introduction, and then eventually a sonata allegro movement based on one of his early song cycles, the second piece from the Song of a Wayfarer. Second movement, since the first movement is kind of mellow, second movement is actually the scherzo in this case, or the waltz, in this case a Landler, a folk waltz that really anticipated the true waltz. Then our featured movement, it's the third movement, the image, at least the initial inspiration from a woodcut, an image of animals that hunters hunt, bearing a dead hunter on a bier, like Dido's bier, and they're taking him to the graveyard, and they're weeping mock tears, and it's the huntsman's funeral. How to depict? A do-so down low on timpani, and this is 8 years before also Sparks the Orchestra. Then it's Ferrajaca in a minor key. Woo! When I first heard this in Pittsburgh at my grandmother's house when I was a kid, I was totally impressed, and I thought, totally weird to have Ferrajaca in a minor key. Turns out, that's not even Mahler's idea. Evidently, it was a tradition in Austria to do it that way. So he doesn't write the theme. A lot of composers don't write the themes. It's how you use them. To that, he actually adds this little kind of fanfare-y, bird song, folky thing as do, 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 me, do, so, do, 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 so, do, so, le, so, 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 do, so, so, do, so, fa, me, re. And this is a dirge. Dirge is a death march, a funeral procession. So we actually have in the third movement, it's like another dance. Then this is as close to a slow movement as you actually get. And it is actually couched in, the march in trio form, with the march repeated, the dirge repeated. So we got a big A, that's the big A. The little A, that's half the big A. The little A is that stuff. The little B is barroom song, gypsy, cafe, Jewish folk song, military music as well, all interwoven. Wonderful stuff. And then back to Ferrajaca, which degenerates into the trio section. That's in D minor. The whole piece starts in D major, by the way. Second movement is what? A major. This trio now from D minor, we're going to G major. Turns out it's another one of the Song of the Wayfarers, now done orchestrally. Didn't even know it until a couple years ago when my partner Harriet played it for me. That's more of an orchestral guy than an art song guy, what can I say? There's really two parts of that. It turns a little wonderfully dark again by going sort of G minor-ish. You get three flutes on a cadential passage, and again, it's a giant orchestra. We've got at least four each of the woodwinds and brass. The fourth oboe only plays in the final movement. I remember that because the DVC orchestra asked me to come in as a free ringer. It goes back now, this music, to the Ferrajaca, but when it comes back, it's not in D minor, it's in E flat minor. And the deal there is, if you got perfect pitch, you're bothered. Even if you don't, in D minor, there's D string on all the strings, right? Remember the open strings of all four of the string instruments as being G, D, A, and well, cello and the viol don't have the E string, do they? They have the C, but whatever. So D minor resonates very well. E flat minor, not so much. It's going to be muffled, strange, and then it lurches back into D major, and then it's like the barroom marching band kind of interrupts for a second. Wonderfully violent change of tempo, depending on this recording. We'll see whether they really give it the teeth. And then ultimately, the whole, oh, there's an extra melody that comes back in the little B section. And then ultimately dying out, not with a bang, but a whimper. The last notes, a wonderful orchestrational touch of string bass with the bass drum whap would make Berlioz proud, and a through line in terms of harmony and orchestration. You can trace Berlioz, Liszt, Wagner, Bruckner, who incidentally is Mahler's teacher, and then continuing on to Schoenberg, and there's time for that.